The table exists because
it's a group of people, you know, who wants to make a difference in the community. And
we just want to make sure that San Francisco and everybody that comes to the table feels the love of Jesus.
This city, this area, there's a lot of people that have faith here, but a lot of the churches here don't necessarily provide that community. And
so many formalities, there's so many things that, you know, that put us in boxes, and I feel like the table is a welcoming place.
A table is open, a table is not closed doors. A table is for anyone who can come, be together, and commune with one another.
That no matter where you are, even if you don't believe, even if you, you know, have questions or have doubts, wherever you are in your faith, that we're, you know, a place where we really are welcoming people to have a conversation.
It's a church that really wants you to use your gifts, use who you are to serve God. And what I think that brings out kind of a unique type of creativity that
we're not judging people. It doesn't matter if you're black, white, orange, blue. I mean, we're not here to talk about your hair. We're just here to accept you for who you are. And
the table is that place that welcomes your conversation, but the underpinning message is God's love and favor, and that He is the answer, and He does have purpose for you and for your life.
So we invite you to come and be who you are, to process your own faith and where you are with that, as well as help us bless this beautiful city called San Francisco. Join us at the table.
Who do you see? That is our message this morning. Who do you see? And I just want to say it's a lifelong process as we get into this. And just want to be looking at a passage this morning in Matthew 9. It's a passage that shaped my life in becoming a Jesus follower and continues to shape my life. And Jesus is wanting to encourage each of us here in this place and in the places that we will end up going to help us see people. That is why we exist. Jesus wants to teach us and encourage us to see people that are broken and beautiful and harassed. And secondly, Jesus wants to show us people and actually see these people who need prayer. And then lastly, He wants us to see people that are being brought in and are being clothed, that aren't just naked, but are being clothed and then are being sent out so that they may bring others in. Many of you have been coming up to me telling me that you visited San Francisco in the last few days, and you couldn't help but tell me some of the things that you saw while you were there. Wow, the Salesforce Tower, the tallest building west of Chicago, over 1,000 feet tall. People going uphill riding a skateboard. How's that happening? Wow. It's the techies. They're holding a little remote control thing. Little doggies in a backpack, nestled real cutely in a backpack while their owner travels to work on a bicycle. Someone riding their bicycle with a surfboard attached to the bicycle. Lots of diversity, lots of social injustice that you maybe saw while you were there. Lots of needles on the streets. The smell of 420 everywhere. 420, you know about that? Yes, okay. The smell of marijuana everywhere. I got to translate some things here, sorry. And then some of you came up to me and you actually said, and we saw the naked guy, as if there's only one naked person in San Francisco. As if when visitors come to San Francisco, we cue the naked guy. Okay, cue the naked guy. And if any of you have taken public speaking course, you know what they teach you, don't they? That you're supposed to see your audience as all naked people. I don't see you in that way. So I just need to get that out in the open, that we're talking about naked people. We do this in San Francisco. Jesus is not wanting to leave us naked in our discussion this morning and our time together. He wants us to see people as being clothed. Let me take a moment before we dive into our text here and just give you a great thanks and thanksgiving for your support of the table that's being set, that you truly are the legs underneath this table. We really see a church forming. We are a part, not because we're doing something unique or great or creative, but that God is really calling us into a process to be ourselves and to minister to people that He's already chosen and elected, and he's gathering those types of people together. And we just get to be a part of the beauty that's really happening in San Francisco. So thanks for your financial support. Thanks to all of our donors. Thanks to all of you that have prayed for us and pray regularly. This church in particular has a prayer room. It's right over there. And before you come out here and speak, there's a place where you can pray, and then like a group of people come and pray over you. That may be normal to you, but that's not normal where I come from in San Francisco. People aren't just coming up to you asking you, how can we pray for you? What do you need in prayer right now? That is tremendous. A tremendous level of encouragement and support is your prayer investment and your prayer support for me and for my family. My wife and my mom in love, I don't call her my mom-in-law, but my mom in love and my dad in love are visiting from Winston-Salem right now. They're watching live stream. And just want to say thank you, church family, for praying for my mom in love, Barbara. She, as you know, has been suffering with stage 4 ovarian cancer. And just her most recent visit to see her doctor and oncologist and that medical team, she told that team, that medical team, that her daughter, Caroline, my wife, had this crazy idea for them to come and visit us in San Francisco this week. And so she threw out that idea to her medical team, and the medical team was like, absolutely. You're doing well enough, you should go to San Francisco. So shout out to you and even to my mom in love who's watching right now that you've been confident all along that Jesus is right there in the boat with you in the midst of the storms of your suffering. Those are the people that Jesus sees. Let's read our text this morning and let's look at a few things that Jesus wants us to see as we engage with people in our world. As Jesus went throughout all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom and healing every disease and affliction, when he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray earnestly to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest." Let us pray. Jesus, it's in your name that we pray and we pledge glad allegiance to you, King Jesus, this morning, this new day where your mercy is new. And we pray that you would help us see people the way that you see people. We pray that you would help us see ourselves in the way that you see us. And we pray that you would indeed send out laborers into your harvest field that would bring others in. And we thank you that this is all according to your promise, that you've always been doing this, you'll continue doing this, and so we're grateful for your faithfulness, that you are indeed at work. Guide us now, we pray all this in Jesus' name, amen. First of all, Jesus wants us to see people that are beautiful. San Francisco, maybe similar to your place, is a place full of people with ideas. They're smart, they're beautiful, they're entrepreneurs, they're risk takers, they're pleasure seekers. They're there to create something. They are there because they're hungry, they're thirsty. That was part of the whole concept of us as a team naming this church the table. We want to acknowledge that people are hungry, people are thirsty, people are beautiful, people are creative. They're made by God in this way. God sees you as that way. He sees you as creative. He sees you as beautiful. He sees your friends in this way. And yet, God also, through Jesus and his teaching this morning, wants us to see that people are broken. People are broken. You may not know this about the Golden Gate Bridge. You may be enamored by its beauty, although it is beautiful. But there are hotlines. There are counseling telephone hotlines stretched all the way across the Golden Gate Bridge. Why? Because we're broken. We're broken. Someone might just get a thought that they're not beautiful enough. They haven't created enough. They haven't done enough. Do you meet people like this? Do you know people that struggle with that? Do you struggle with those things? We're not just beautiful. We're broken and we're harassed. Look at our text. Verse 35, Jesus, he's healing every disease and affliction. Here's a point Jesus is saying, that he's not just a preacher man. For you preachers in the room, you're not just a preacher. Jesus is out with people. He's in the towns, he's in the villages, he's healing every disease and every affliction. Why? Because he exists. Why? Because from the fall of humanity, we've been dealing with suffering. Things like cancer, things like an autoimmune system that doesn't work, like my son right now that all of you have been praying for.
Thank you. There's tremendous suffering that's going on. In verse 36, he says, when Jesus saw the crowds. See, Jesus is more than a preacher. Jesus is a shepherd. And in order to see people, you have to be with people. Get out of your pulpit. Get out of your office. Get out of the meetings. Go be with people. And prior to going and being with people, go be with Jesus, who sees you and me in this way. See, we are those people. We are those very people who are broken, who are beautiful, and who are harassed. There's a great documentary called We Were Here. We Were Here. Some of you maybe have seen this. It's a documentary of the AIDS, HIV/AIDS epidemic that swept through San Francisco in the 80s. My cousin, Donald, died of AIDS in San Francisco. But this is a wonderful documentary just to kind of portray some of the brokenness in San Francisco. And as I watched that documentary with different teammates of ours in San Francisco, you had to ask the question, where was the church? Where were you, church? Where were you, pastor? Where were you, preacher? Where were you, body of Christ? This is convicting. This is very convicting. Where were we? And so I just leave us with like a little reflection question here. We do this whenever we meet in San Francisco, as we try to ask questions and give people space to reflect. And here's a question right here for each of us this morning. Do you and I order our day in such a way that we can see people? With your scheduling, with your priorities, with that iPhone, with that calendar, which we're so good at managing. Do we order our day so that we can see people? Or do we see people thinking they just need more order in their lives? If they just stopped thinking this way, and they started thinking this way, if I could just fix them, if I could just change that about that person, everything would become all right. Let's do an exercise, shall we? An exercise. Turn either to the person to your right or to your left, and I want to ask you a question. Who do you see? Don't answer. Don't answer. I can't read thought bubbles, so I don't even know what you're thinking. Who do you see? Who do you see? Typically, okay, you can stop looking now. Getting a little awkward. Typically, whenever we think about someone that we just saw, we might get arrogant. Yeah, we might get arrogant. I'm talking to you, talking to me. We might get arrogant. We typically, when we see someone, we start getting arrogant. We start thinking, you know what? I look better than that person. I have a better education than that person. I'm more well off than that person. Is this getting too uncomfortable for anyone? We start thinking that we're superior to other people. Or we start feeling very inferior to the person that we just saw. We start feeling very self-loathing, almost depressed. Wow, this person's got so much more than I do. This person's so much more gifted than I am. We make fun of people, we make assumptions, we judge them. And my mother was really good at this growing up. And by the way, her backyard was full of people, full of kids, black, white, gay, straight, whoever. Come, be yourself, belong, be a part of community. And what she taught all of us, not just me, but all of us, is that everybody has a story. Don't assume you know it. Don't put people in categories. Listen. Take time to invest in someone when you see them. Don't assume that you know their story. Verse 36, look at what Jesus is doing. When Jesus sees people, Jesus is having compassion. Jesus is having compassion because they were harassed and helpless. See, this is what a shepherd does. See, what you see is indicative to who you are. Jesus isn't there to take advantage of those that he sees. He isn't there to use people that he ends up seeing, but he sees them as harassed and helpless. He sees them as harassed by the fall of humanity. All of us know, at least in this room, the four acts of human history. One, there's this incredible beginning that we all had when God created us with perfect harmony with, with each other and with God and the creation, known as creation. And then the second act of all of human history, the crash. A catastrophic crash that took place, the fall of humanity. And then third act of human history, that there would be this Redeemer, Christ the Redeemer, would come into the mess, come into the chaos, come into our world and offer hope. And then the last act of human history, which we're all longing for, please hurry up and come, Lord Jesus, where there's this creative restoration that's going to take place. But meanwhile, we're harassed. Do you see people this way? You see people as just wealthy, and you know what? They got it all together. Oh my, she's beautiful, or oh my, he's handsome. They're strong, they're brilliant, they're bright, they're creative. How could they need Jesus? You ever thought that before? You ever been intimidated by that before? You ever lived somewhere where everyone around you seems like everything is perfect? You need to know better. You need to know better, and you need to see, as Jesus is seeing, that the people and we are not just beautiful people, but they're broken, they're harassed. And that we're harassed by injustice as well. There's racism and classism all around you. It's all around me and my city. Harassed by injustice of sex trafficking, harassed by sickness and disease like cancer and autoimmune systems that don't work. That's harassment that's coming against us as human beings. And harassed by our own willful pursuit of sin. Who wants to admit that one? That's harassment coming against you. Peter, one of the writers in the New Testament, says, sinful desires that war against our souls. Do you feel that? Are you awake enough this morning to even acknowledge that that's there inside of us? That controversy, that conflict that exists, that harassment that's there inside of us, Jesus sees all of that inside of you. He knows everything about you. And that's why it says he has compassion right there, not judgment, compassion. Jesus saying, I'm not here to harass you. I'm not here to use you and cheat on you and lie on you and steal from you as everything else is doing in your lives. I'm here to have compassion on you. I know every part about your story. And then there's this harassment by Satan. Satan himself, the ultimate bully. And there's new believers at the table where we're worshiping and seeing this church get started. And there's young believers. And what we're learning to tell these new and young believers is, go tell Satan to go talk to your defense attorney, Jesus. He's your lawyer. Go tell Satan to go to hell. Go tell him. He's harassing you. I felt some of that last night. I felt some of that this morning, being pushed around, being bullied, being accused. Satan wanting me and wanting all of us to think that we don't belong. We're fraud. We're wasting our time. What are we doing? Right? If my adventure in San Francisco as a church planter is all about money, then I'm out. If this is all about let's be anxious and nervous about how the money's going to work out, I'm going to go do something else. If your role as ministers, pastors, deacons, elders, church planters, anyone listening right now, if your role is all about just doing church, please leave. Please get out of that profession. What a waste of time. Jesus is calling us to see people. It's all about seeing these people whom Jesus sees. So don't see people as sex objects. That's a life takeaway right there. Don't see people as sex objects. Learn, keep learning to see others, women, children, men, others, in the way that Jesus did. Don't see people as political objects. We just gotta say that one. Don't see people as political objects that it's like your role for some reason that you gotta change them. You gotta convert them. If everyone were just Republicans, well, it would all just work out. And no, if everyone were just Democrats, or independents, it would all just work out. Jesus is other. We are here to pledge glad allegiance to King Jesus. So stop harassing others. Do you see people, and do you see yourselves as those people who are harassed? Next, people who need prayer. People need prayer. Jesus is not prescribing anxiety in this text. If you read this text and you started feeling anxiety about how we're going to build the kingdom and, oh no, we got to build the next generation and it's all up to us, please reread the text. It's not about anxiety. It's not about what you need to do or I need to do, and if we just call the right, most gifted, most whatever people and like position those people, then we're bound to make it work. We're bound to make an influence. That's incorrect. Jesus doesn't prescribe anxiety. He doesn't prescribe anxious strategic meetings about how to do the kingdom. He prescribes prayer. He prescribes prayer. Verse 38, pray. Pray earnestly. And he reminds them, Jesus is an incredible discipler. He's discipling as he goes. He's always doing evangelism and discipleship, like simultaneously. He's discipling. He frames it by saying, pray earnestly, and in case you're forgetting who you're praying to, pray to the Lord of the harvest. See, that's who Jesus is. Jesus owns the harvest. Jesus understands the urgency. He told his disciples and other places in the New Testament, do you not say 4 more months and then the harvest? I tell you plainly, open your eyes and see. See that the harvest is ripe. It's white. It's right now. Get outside of yourself. See the harvest in the way that I see it. Verse 38, again, he's just saying that he is this Lord of the harvest, and it reminds me of Paul in his writing in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 7, where he says, and he's speaking to any of you who are church planters and any of you who are strategists and into growth and multiplication and those kind of things. This verse is especially for you. He says, so neither the one who plants nor the one who waters is anything, but only God who makes things grow. That's amazing, amazing reminder that growth, sustainability, multiplication, the kingdom extending globally, it's gonna happen. It's been happening. See people in process. Here's a reflection question for us. Do you and I spend as much time in prayer to the Lord of the harvest for people as we do in our minds thinking what would fix people? I'll repeat it. Do we spend more time judging people and putting people in categories than we do praying to the Lord of the harvest to raise up laborers? Back in college, many years ago, I was afraid of Jesus. Oh, I'd heard of his name. I knew different people that said they had a relationship with Jesus, but I was running from Jesus. I didn't want anything to do with Jesus because I felt like he was chasing me with a straitjacket. Come be a part of these rules. Stop listening to this music. Stop sleeping with that person. Stop thinking this about that. Do these things. Scare me to death. Many of you perhaps have had the same kind of story. And a lot of the people that I meet in San Francisco too want nothing to do with that Jesus. And the beauty of it all is that's not Jesus. That's not Jesus. Jesus, with unbelievable liberal compassion, is calling you and was calling me as a college student to remind me through an individual, through a fraternity brother, that Jesus was not chasing me with a straitjacket. Jesus simply wanted to take it off. Jesus wants to give you freedom, Troy, to experience pleasure and risk and challenge and complexity, which I've made you for, like you've never experienced it. You're hungry, I made you that way. But you're looking for it in all these other ways. No wonder your soul is restless. Come to me, all of you who are hungry, Jesus says. Jesus sees people in your neighborhood, in my neighborhood, just like that, who need this prayer. Let's do another exercise. Don't have to look at someone to your right or to your left. You're like, whew. Take just a moment right now and pray. Literally, right now. Take just a moment and pray for that someone. Pray to this Lord of the harvest for that someone that may seem two together may seem too beautiful, may seem not even in need of God's grace. Pray for that person. Pray for the person that seems too far outside of God's reach. Oh, God's grace couldn't dare go to that person, could it? Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Pray for that person right now. Amen. And then lastly, we're going to look at this third point here of Jesus sees people who are being brought in so that they can be sent out to bring others in. Verse 38, pray to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers. You realize in John chapter 4, when Jesus sees the woman at the well, and she goes and tells others in the village about this man who knew everything about me. You realize what it says near the end of that chapter 4 there, that it says that many in the village came to believe in Jesus because of her testimony. Because of her testimony. That's the way Jesus does it. Jesus is building his kingdom through you. Through you and through you. John 10, he does the same kind of language. I am the good shepherd. I have other sheep. And he's blowing his disciples' mind at this point in their discipleship process. You have other disciples. Well, who are they? I thought we were the only ones. It's all about us, right? No, I have other sheep. I know them. I will call them by name. They will come to me when they hear your words. Wow. Beautiful both and going on there. Oh, I thought we were about Reformed theology. Yes. I thought we were about kingdom extension. Yes. He does it one more time in John 17 in the high priestly prayer. I pray not only for these disciples. Do you know how the rest of this goes? But I pray for those who will believe in me through their message. Wow. Wow. Jesus is about bringing others in. Jesus is about helping people know that they've been seen in a way that they've never been seen before. See, when you know you've been seen in this way, when you know that you've been accepted in this way and loved in this way and cherished in this way, it unleashes you. It gives you incredible, undescribable freedom to then begin to see and be on a journey where you're learning how to see. And Lord, give us mercy to see people in that way. One final exercise, and we'll close with this. This is just a time of prayer for each of us. This is what it all comes down to right here. This is what it comes down to. One final prayer. One final prayer is that is to look right now, not to your right or to the left or to a friend that we were just praying for, but look right at the Lord of the harvest right now. Look at this Jesus right now who sees you, who's compassionately dealing with you in all of your complexities, in all of your inconsistencies, in all of your struggles. Look at that Jesus. And pray, Lord, send out laborers into your harvest. And lastly, Lord, send me. Send me. Not because I'm great, but because you are.